guys. Thanks a lot for tuning in today's Florida Drive-By. I'm on the I-75. I'm actually going northbound. I hope everybody's doing great. Today's July 13th, 2016. And it's about 71 degrees, wet and rainy. We're in the rainy season. Going over the Gulf right now. Not traffic, there's a tow truck. That's a big tow truck that can tow a big truck. But I hope everybody's doing great. Wednesday, midweek, over the hump day, I guess. I hope everybody's doing great. And today, you know, I want to bring up a subject today at 7:49 in the evening about, if you believe the body has a spirit. You know, I was just listening to a lot of different things, and there was just a situation where a motorcycle guy got hit by a car, and there was a guy passing by or something. The guy took a picture, and I guess he took a picture, and it shows the picture of his spirit leaving his body. And so it's brought a little controversy. Now, there was another case where two girls were standing on a sidewalk, and a car, the guy, I guess, had a heart attack or something, happened. The car went over the sidewalk. Ran the one girl over and hit the other one. And of course, the girl that got ran over died, but the other one got knocked out. And when she was unconscious, she saw her body floating above the car, and saw the body of the girl that died, saw her soul. And then her body went back into her, you know, her soul went back into her body, and she woke up. But the other girl did die still. So there's a lot of cases like this, and you know, some people, you know, it really revolves on a basis of faith. You know, if you look at this world, it's really strange. We have no idea where we came from. You know, we think it's evolution. You know, it's really weird. Mankind, you know, everybody goes to their day-to-day jobs, does their thing, try to survive. And has anybody ever looked at, you know, just thought about everything around you and where we came from? A lot of people do not. You know, they don't think about, you know, where they came from, who they are, and it's really, when you start thinking about it, it's a really, really strange thing. So, you know, today I want to just, you know, do a little discussion and talk about that. You know, everybody out there, my subscribers, and just if you're just casually, you know, found my YouTube channel for the first time in my drive-by, you know, I'd like to know what you think. What do you think? Do we have a spirit? Does it leave our body? Does it go somewhere? Or, you know, they did this, I mean, years ago, there's more than one theories. They usually break up the theories into that your body, I can't remember, it's something with ethics and philosophy. But one is, your body is just a bag of chemicals, and your conscience is not really a conscience. It's just a reaction from all these chemicals reacting. So you're just one big bag of bones. The other one is that you're separate. You have an organic part for you, and you have a spiritual part. The spiritual part is like, you know, a spirit controlling everything. So there's a separation of mind and body. You have the bag of chemicals, and then you have another part of you, which is a spirit. Sort of, I guess, like, say, the engine that runs the car, the engine that runs the body. So, you know, I think it's called dualism. Yeah, I think it's called dualism. Duality of man. I don't know what the other one's called, but there's two of them. One is that your mind, your body is separate from your mind. The other one is you are just a result of organic reactions. You're one thing. When you die, you're gone. The other one, they believe, when your body dies, your spiritual part moves on, but there's more. And I'd like to know what you guys think. You know, it's really deeply rooted in philosophy and Aristotle, Plato, most of those famous theologians and philosophers, they all believed in a God. I mean, even Einstein believed in a God. You know, most of your great scientific thinkers, the more scientific they are, the more they thought about it, and the more they believe in God, because the more the design, when they look how infinite is the design, they realize that there has to be more. And I'd like to know what you guys think. Okay, it's fogging up my windows, so kind of hot in here, so I'm going to try to get rid of some of this. Defrost the windows. Try to get rid of that. I'll clear it up. There you go. But, I'd like to know what you guys think about this, because, you know, it's a very tough subject, because, you have religion, you have, there's really a lot of religion is involved in it too, don't forget. But, you know, we're talking about a spirit, a soul, or we're talking about something else, if you think about it, is just the human being just a big glob of protoplasm with nothing there? Doesn't make it very divine or special, does it? You know, are we just like a raccoon that got hit by the side of the road? You know, I really believe everything has some kind of life energy. If you want to call it a spirit, I won't call it if you want to give it a definition. But even a raccoon, a dog, a cat, they're living creatures that have something in them to make them real. So if we have a spirit, they have a spirit. Or is it just a bag of chemicals? And just the natural reactions that occur inside the body, that bring our awareness in life. Those are a lot of things that, are decisions and things you have to really get deep into metaphysical theology to really realize these things. Is there more? As I was driving, I started thinking about that, That's a subject that you could devote your whole life to. And a lot of the old theologians and philosophers did. They devoted their lives to that. They some of them found the answer and didn't tell anybody. And some never found the answer. Or did they find the answer and went to the grave with that answer? There's an old saying, there's stranger things than heaven and earth. And we have to realize that there is. Because where we are now, we look at this very simple, simplistic world that we have made it. And look what we do. I mean, we're building homes and chopping trees down and thinking about our sewers and our gutters and our house and what meal we make the next day and maybe what gun or what firearm or what car we buy or what boat or what necklace or what dress or what shoes or whatever. And you're looking around you right here, and just a leaf on a tree, how wonderful that is. Just think about it, guys. Just think about this. If you didn't think about anything else in your life, think about this. Human beings breathe in oxygen. They take the O2, which is, that's the formula, the molecular formula for O2, two parts of oxygen. It's bounded together, it's a gas. They take that out and they let out CO2. Okay, so they take the CO, they take the O2 into the body, combine it with the carbon to get rid of the carbon, and water, carbon dioxide, water. They let out CO2, carbon dioxide and a little water. Right? So CO2, one part carbon, two part oxygen. That goes out into the air. Without oxygen, we could not live. Life would cease to exist on it. And many plants and many animals use that, fish in the ocean. That oxygen gets dissolved into the oceans. The fish use it, an aquatic form of oxygen, and stuff like that, right? Now, the carbon dioxide that we let out of our body, plants breathe in. They don't actually breathe, but they're like an osmosis type. They absorb it through pores in their leaves. So they take in the carbon dioxide, and they take that carbon molecule, and they let out O2. Think about just that one thing if you never thought about anything in your life at all, okay? Human beings take in O2, let out CO2. Plants take in CO2 and let out O2. So the oxygen that plants let out give us life, and the carbon dioxide we let out give plants life. If you don't have to think about anything else in this world, if you want to think about evolution, don't think about it, just think about that. And there's many more wonderful processes and things on this earth. Certainly animals. And here's another one. There's a coral snake, right? Which is very poisonous and dangerous. They got it in Florida. Then there's another snake, which is not a coral snake. He basically looks almost identical to the poisonous coral snake. The only difference is because certain where the red and the black bands meet. But he looks almost identical. He's developed that camouflage so other animals, when they look at him, don't attack him, and they think he's that poisonous coral snake. Now, people say it's evolution, but how the hell? Okay, I'm very simplistic. You know, human beings, our brains are just, how the hell is evolution gonna know to give this guy these color stripes and give that other guy these color stripes? How the hell can you possibly tell me that that's gonna happen? How? Something's got to know. Something's got to go. I mean, how can that be evolution you develop? That makes absolutely no sense to my brain, okay? And if we're talking about evolution, scientists use their brain for these theories, right? That makes no sense. And even saying, how the hell can you letting out oxygen, you letting out carbon dioxide, and a plant taking in the carbon dioxide and letting out oxygen be evolution? How the hell can that happen? Because number one, which came first, the chicken or the egg? The human being needs the carbon dioxide, right, to let out. He needs to let that out to the environment, right? And the plant needs to take the carbon dioxide in and let out the oxygen. So how the hell, which one would be created first? It would have to happen at the same time, wouldn't it, guys? You'd have to have carbon dioxide and oxygen at the same time. Otherwise, neither creature would exist, because you wouldn't have carbon dioxide and you wouldn't have oxygen. The stuff that we need and the plants need wouldn't be around, so how the hell could there be life? Just think about that. How could that be evolution? And there's actually bacteria that are anaerobic that don't use oxygen. That's why if you get a really bad infection, some bacteria are anaerobic, so you can expose them to oxygen. Sometimes that can kill them. But the anaerobic ones will grow because they don't need oxygen. So, I mean, there's just... Just think about the one thing of the plant. Don't even go about, origin of the species. But when they did origin of the species, okay, they were talking about postbiotic evolution, not prebiotic evolution, okay? Prebiotic evolution is evolution before the organism was designed, before it was here. Prebiotic evolution of man would be when man is a single cell. That's what you're talking about. Postbiotic evolution is after the man's already created. So the man's created and goes through, they did the origin of species, the birds, the turtles, the lizards, the birds, some birds on this part of the island had longer beaks than birds on this side of the island, but the birds already existed, and then through evolution, they adapted to the environment. Okay. That's different than saying the bird got created out of a cell, they crawled out of the water, or the man. That's two different things. So the origin of species focuses on postbiotic evolution, which means the organism is already created. Really, the fish is already there, the human being's already there, and if you study a human being over a period of, 200 years, or 1,000 years, or whatever, however long he's been, and you can see his fingers are getting a little longer, or his hair's getting darker, or something like that. Well, that's postbiotic evolution. That's post-evolutionary theory. That's not pre-evolutionary theory. A lot of people bring up this pre-evolutionary theory, which is bringing about mankind, how he got here. He was a cell, the cell grew, turned into a slime, the slime got some legs, it crawled out of the water, blah, blah, blah. I'm not too keen on the prebiotic evolution. I don't know if I can say I believe that, because that's going to really an extreme. That's trying to explain how the plants and mankind got here on Earth. And then, of course, how one was designed to take oxygen and one was designed to take carbon dioxide. I don't know how you could explain that. I don't think any rational person with a normal brain could ever, justify that for an evolutionary theory. Because, for evolution, something, which came first, the chicken or the egg, something's got to be there. And the way it makes it look like is everything's quadratically, like the plants and mankind came at the same time. And if they came at the same time, it's definitely not evolution. And I'm not one preaching the gospel and being all over, the gods here. And I'm saying evolution does not point enough. And we don't have enough proof of evolution. We have proof of postbiotic evolution or post-evolution, which is the organism's already here, and even that is that proof. Here's another one. Why, if you look at a robin, not a robin, a cardinal, which is a red bird, a male cardinal is not real bright. Oh, I'm sorry, a male cardinal is real bright. A female is dull. How is that figured? Why? How does that figure? Do you figure that out? So, there's different things like this, that you have to look, why? How does this occur evolutionary? One bird's real bright, one bird's real dark. One's a female, one's a male. Why would that happen? That is something that we at this point, nobody knows. They bring it up to evolution, right? To evolution. One's dark, one's light. Who knows, guys? Who knows? It's just really strange. So why would, the cardinal, why would the male be bright red and the female not be bright red? See, it's very interesting. I mean, when we get into the evolutionary theory, It's very freaking confusing. It's a confusing subject. It really is. And I don't think many people understand it. And today, with our society, we look around, and these people all just, I don't think they know what the hell's going on. They really don't. I mean, I think they're walking around with empty cannons. So you have to think about that. When somebody talks about evolution, ask them if they're talking about prebiotic evolution or postbiotic evolution. Once again, prebiotic evolution is before the organism's created. Cellular level, grown out of the slime. Postbiotic evolution is after the organism's created and it's there. We'll give you two ways. So let's say prebiotic evolution. The cell forms a cell, gets out of the water, starts crawling, the fish have feet, start working, changes into monkey goes to the man, blah, 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 okay? Prebiotic evolution. Postbiotic evolution. The man is created. However the man is created. God, they have to be dying, probably. So the man is created. And slowly over years, the his fingers grow longer, you know, maybe he'll get pigmentation in the skin, things like that, you know, changes, evolutionary changes to them while they're here. I mean, that's usually the two theories. And which one holds more water? Which one's more? If you look at some facts, like your coral snake, right, which there's a fully poisonous one that has certain color bands, and then there's one that looks identical to the poisonous one. The only difference is, I think the band touches the white rather than the red or something, just the difference of one band, and that's enough to keep animals away from it, birds of prey. How the hell did that happen? Who knew? I mean, you know what I mean? It's like, crawling out of that water, who knew that a bird, you know, that a certain animal was going to try to attack that and wouldn't attack that if it was a certain color? And identifying it with that reverse band. It did that too. It didn't make it identical. It made a reverse band. And I can't remember what it is, but if you look it up on the internet, you can see a regular poisonous coral snake and a non-poisonous, it's just an imitation snake. You know, you can look at that and they'll say on the poisonous one, the bands are a certain way, just two bands. And non-poisonous ones look just like the poisonous ones. The bands are touching white or black, and they're just one band is a little different. How the hell can that happen? A reasonable, intelligent person would look at that and say, how's that going to happen? How's that the animal going to know something's going to attack and something it? You know, is it going to turn on a gene by itself? How does it know? Who knows? And the same thing with the carbon dioxide and the oxygen. How would, you know, a plant know it's got to take in carbon dioxide and let out oxygen? And how would a human know, you know, that it's going to be taking in oxygen and letting out carbon dioxide? How would evolution do that? Only you have both. You have carbon dioxide, you have probably oxygen in the environment, you probably had that right along. Because if you had an animal that just took all carbon dioxide in, right, eventually there would be no more carbon dioxide. And if you had a living creature taking just an oxygen, eventually they would use up all the oxygen and there'd be no more oxygen. So here, you have a plant making oxygen. You have organisms taking in the carbon dioxide that the plant's letting out. So there's never too much. It's in balance. It's a check and balance. It's really friggin' amazing. It's amazing and it's strange. Who knows? I mean, you know, every time, when I'm going for a walk and I see a darn turtle, I think focus is out because it's focusing on the raindrops. I see a turtle, I look at a damn turtle, I say, oh my God, look at that thing. It's got a shell, and it can go into its shell. How the hell? You know, look at the animals, armadillos, raccoons. I mean, just look at nature and look what's out there in front of your eyes, and they can give you more of a decision to make what you believe in. You know, it's tough. You can get to the point where you don't want to believe in anything, but you got to believe in something, because we know there's more than just us. There's more than us. And there's a universe out there with stars and planets and everything. Guys, it's phenomenal. And it's, I don't know how anybody could understand this. So bottom line is, walk through your life tall and walk through your life with a purpose to believe. Because there's something there, we don't know what. Just because we don't know the answer doesn't mean it isn't the answer. And you know what they say? I think they say the sum of the parts is greater than a whole or whatever, or the sum of the parts can never be greater than the whole. So you think about that. All the sum of the parts make the whole. Make the common good. So thanks a lot, guys. This is my video today. And this is just, you know, a thought I was having on a rainy Florida Wednesday, July 13th. And I'll be coming up on 61, July 15th is Friday. So God gave me another year. Hopefully he'll give me a few more years, you know, with my surgery and everything. But once again, thanks a lot, guys, for viewing. And I hope you find this video interesting. But it's just really a strong thought, you know, and a strong feeling.
funny that I think about this. And, I mean, I drive a lot, and every time I see the damn plants, I start thinking, those plants are taking in carbon dioxide, and they're letting out oxygen. I just look at that, and I say, that's great, I'm taking in oxygen. It's, like, amazing. It's a check and balance. It's an ecosystem. And I can't see evolution creating that. I don't know how it would happen. I don't, you know, put it this way, you know, if there was oxygen, I mean, where'd the oxygen even come for the first animal to breathe it in, right? What did we have back then? Was there anything making oxygen? Where'd it come from? I'm not sure if ozone breaks into oxygen. I'm not sure if that breaks us in. Breaks up. I'm not sure if that breaks up. I could always check. If that breaks down, that's a good question. Because that would be, could be part of the oxygen. But, yeah, because, what it is the ozone, which is O3, gets broken up by ultraviolet light in the atmosphere, too. And that produces some oxygen, too. So, we get that, too. But, you know, we do get certain amounts, but by far we get more oxygen from plants. But that's another form. The UV breaks it up and makes it. So the oxygen and carbon dioxide probably was here, you know, maybe the beginning of the formation of the Earth. The problem is when you're looking into this, it's a big problem. You know what the problem is, guys? How did organisms decide that they're going to be breathing this thing and not breathing? That, you know, that's a really scary thought, guys. It really is. But thanks a lot, and I appreciate it. I'm actually in Kings Highway over here. I'm trying to burn. I got to get off and get gas. So I'm going to go get some gas. Gas is pretty cheap today out here in Florida. Hopefully it won't go up. If it does, you know, I've got a pretty small car here that gets very good gas mileage because I drive a lot. I drive quite a bit, but it comes sporadically. Sometimes I'll have, you know, 5 service calls in a week that are, you know, each maybe 150, 200 miles apiece. And then sometimes I have a 20-mile one, and in a week I might have no calls. So it depends. And it's kind of all right because I work when I want. I can make money when I want. But the problem is when I'm not working, I'm not making money. And, a lot of the, stuff I got on my channel, the stuff I purchase, I buy all that stuff, those are all mine and I own them. There's nobody that, gives me the stuff, so it gets expensive. I've cut back a little because I hit some bills. So, but thanks a lot, guys. I appreciate everybody's time. I appreciate everybody. If you've been listening to me this far in this video, I appreciate that too. It's really, you guys honor me. When I get 1 view or 10 views, it doesn't matter. I'm honored by the YouTube community. I think there's a lot of great people there. And I'm going to try keep good videos and keep as many videos as I can get. And a lot of the stuff that I put out there is stuff I truly believe in. Even if I put a little thing about a gun or something, that's information that, try to keep it as concise as I can for you guys. So you guys, can know stuff about it, Oh yeah, there's a Q5 out by Walter, a 9mm with optics and everything. That's a pretty sweet gun, guys. I think I did a small overview of it. I'm looking to get one, so if I get one, I'll do a hands-down review of that. That might be a keeper because it's a 9mm and it's all set up, It's got some ports on the side. It's not a ported gun, it's just a skeletonized. But putting a few ports on that would maybe make it handle pretty good. But thanks a lot. I'm going to pull and get my gas over here at the mobile. Thanks a lot, guys. Appreciate you tuning into my video. And once again, God bless you. Thanks a lot on a rainy day in Florida.